Well, hey, my name is Taylor Wilkerson. Maybe today's your first time if you've never gotten to meet me. Man, I'm so thankful that you're here today. Kristen and I, we love you so much. We love this city so much. I can't believe that it's already been almost 6 years since we relaunched Glad Tidings Tabernacle as Trinity. And man, look what the Lord has done. He's delivered us through a building that got destroyed. We became a pop-up church. And then the pandemic happened. We became an online church. And God's delivered us through so much. And now here we are again, regathering in a new location. And I'm so thankful to be joined with us. And we have friends who are here in the room. Can you give it up for yourselves for coming to church today? I think you deserve a big round of applause. And then we also have so many friends who join us online, our online community. They're on Zoom, they're on YouTube. And what I think is so special about that, what's so special about the presence of God is He can meet us anywhere. And so whether you're in your living room today or you're in your bedroom, the East Coast, the West Coast, no matter where you are, I want you to know that you belong and that God loves you today. And I think God has a word just for you. Everyone in the room, can we just welcome everyone who's joining us online today? You got to be really loud so they can hear you. Come on. They've got to feel the love. They got to feel the love. Well, hey, we are in this series called Love Songs. We're in the series called Love Songs, and I'm so honored to be able to share with you today. It's been a really fun series as we've been studying the Song of Solomon. I'm going to see if I get my fancy clicker to work. Let's see. Is it working? It is. So cool. So if you go to the very beginning to the Song of Songs or the Song of Solomon, if you open up your Bibles real quick, we've learned a few things, and we always start with this scripture. And this is Song of Solomon verses 1 and 2. And this is a book of poetry. This is a book that was written. This is a love song. Anyone love some good love songs? Valentine's was last week. I mean, some of you married folk, come on. Hopefully you had a few good love songs playing last Monday. Today is going to be a fun topic. We're going to be talking about sex. Did you feel the awkward pause? That was intentional. I wanted you to feel it for a moment. Sex shouldn't be something that's awkward. It should be something that's celebrated, especially when we do it God's way. There's so much blessing. But right here in the very beginning, if you're just joining us, I just want to kind of catch you up to what's happening. You see, this is a book. This is a song. This is a poem. This is a book of poetry that was written by King Solomon. He was known as the wisest king. Historically, we know he's one of the wealthiest men, one of the wealthiest rulers ever, like in antiquity. It's absolutely incredible what God did through him. His dad was David, who meaning that he was the third king of Israel. And he did so many amazing things. And David, Solomon, he wrote over 1,000 songs. And in fact, he wrote 1,005 that we know of, 1,005 songs. That he's a songwriter. He would be like top 20 on the playlist for sure. He would have had a few big hits. But Solomon, he says by his own words, verse 1, it says that this is Solomon's Song of Songs. That's a tool that we see in the Bible so many times, like where we call Jesus, he is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords. What does that mean? It means he's the king above all other kings. It means that he's the Lord. He's the only true living God. So Solomon, he's saying this is the Song of Songs, meaning that this song is my best song. That's a pretty bold thing for him to say. So he starts off by saying, this song is my best song, and then it starts. And in this story, you have three voices in this song. You have a woman, you have a young man, and you have a group of friends. Because how many of you know that that group of friends is never going to stay out of y'all business? But that's actually a good thing, to have the right voices in your life speaking into it. It's not supposed to be a bad thing. It's supposed to be a good thing. If you don't have good voices speaking into your relationships, that's why we have groups. You got to get some friends in your life to be the good voices speaking into your relationships. So it starts off right here in verse 2, and this is the young girl, woman speaking. She says, "Let him kiss me with the kisses of his mouth." Ooh-wee. It's getting nice. But he says this, it's more than that. She says, "For your love is more delightful than wine." And what she's speaking to here is more than just a romantic love. You see, what she's really saying is that you are known as someone who's just so good at loving people. You love everyone. You have a reputation of being someone who just loves people. You love your friends. You love your parents. You love your brothers and your sisters. You love everyone God has placed in your life. And she is celebrating that he is someone who has learned how to love well, not just romantically, but learning how to love everyone. Come on, we all want to be that, right? And she actually goes on and she says, pleasing is the fragrance of your perfumes. Pleasing is the fragrance of your perfumes. Your name is like perfume poured out. Again, she's celebrating who he is. When you're mentioned, you just make the whole room better. Your name is like perfume. And he says, no wonder the young woman love you. She's saying, but you're all mine. And she's celebrating that today. So today is going to be a really fun sermon, I hope, I pray. But I want to give some ground rules real quick. The first ground rule here today, I don't think this is working, just so the team knows. But the first ground rule today is, number one, you've got to make sure that you're listening for yourself, not for someone else. So I don't want to see any of that, you better be taking notes now. Don't be doing that. Don't be elbowing your spouse. Don't be saying, like, you better start listening. This is for you. Don't do that. Don't tweet at, never tweet me saying, this is what my pastor said you ought to be doing. Like, no, don't do that. There's another unspoken ground rule. Don't use me in your arguments, okay? That's another unspoken ground rule. The second ground rule here is listen through the lens of your future, not your past. Is really important today. Listen through the lens of your future, not your past, because today we're talking about a subject. I'm not naive. I'm not sitting in a room full of a few hundred virgins. I'm just not. And today the truth is that there is a lot of shame. We've all made mistakes. Nobody's been perfect. But listen to me. Jesus makes all things new. I want you to accept that today. Jesus makes all things new. Don't listen through the lens of your past, because as I start talking, there's going to be a temptation inside to go, well, Pastor, I've already messed this up. I'm already disqualified. I'm already not worthy. This sermon isn't for me. No. That's the enemy speaking to you. That's your insecurity speaking to you. Don't listen to that. Listen through the lens of your future. When you get married, in your wedding vows, you say, from this day forward. That's what we're doing here today. From this day forward. I know yesterday I was an idiot. I know that I've been a mess. But from this day forward, I'm going to do it God's way. And that's the third ground rule today. The third ground rule is that we're going to listen with an open heart, because this is God's way, not our way. And that's really important, because God's way is not the world's way. God's way is not our culture's way. It's a very different way. And there's going to be a temptation to be like, oof, this sounds maybe out of touch with what's happening in our culture. But that's actually the point. It was Tim Keller who said, if you serve a God who fits into all of your cultures and all of your thinkings, like preconceived notions, then you're not serving God. You're serving something that you have created for yourself. God's word, when you open it up, it challenges us. It sharpens us. It makes us better. So today, we got to listen with an open heart. Can we do that? In fact, can you just say that to God real quick as I pray for us? Can we go to God in prayer? Would you just open up your heart to heaven and say, God, I want to listen with an open heart today. God, I want to hear what you have for me. Lord, I pray over each and every person who is here in this room. God, I pray that in joining us online, God, I pray that you would speak to us, that you would encourage us, and that you would make all things new. In Jesus' name, everybody said, amen and amen. And today, you know, it's important that we understand this rule, because we're doing it God's way, and there's something that we need to be reminded of today. And just, I'm going to give a few things before I even get into the scripture. The first thing is that the devil didn't create sex. Did you know that? The devil didn't create it. But right now, it's kind of frustrating as a pastor, because the church has been largely silent on the topic. And the devil has been awfully loud. And so many of us, we come to the table with these preconceived notions that we have learned from culture, from loud voices, from the things that we watch and the voices that we listen to, who have taught us so much. And friends, it's not working. And we need to understand something, that the devil didn't create sex. God created sex. And when you understand that God created sex, you understand that God created sex for our blessing, for our benefit. He actually created sex for our enjoyment. Friends, I think that's pretty awesome, that we need to understand that God created sex, and he created it for our blessing. God wants you to have an incredible sex life when you do it his way. In fact, when you honor God with this part of your life, when you do it his way, no pun intended, when you do it his way, there is blessing, there is intimacy, there is fruit, it is pleasurable. Science and data shows that married couples who are Christians, that they report having a more fulfilled sex life than those who are not doing it that way. That's not just opinion. That's actual, like hundreds of thousands of people surveyed. And we know that people who do it God's way, they're actually more fulfilled. And the world will tell you the opposite. They'll try to convince you to do it another way, but we need to do it God's way. So we need to understand, number one, that God created sex, and that's why we're talking about it today. But the other thing that we need to understand is that men and women are different by God's design. We need to understand that. The men and women, that's not news to you. We all know that men and women are different, but that's by God's design. Especially in the area of sex, like studies show that men can be ready for sex physically in less than 7 seconds. Men are microwaves. Yeah. Do 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 bing, ready to go. Here we go. But women, we all know that women are not that way. If men are microwaves, women are crockpots. Like, we gotta, let that thing simmer all day. You better go take a shower before you get back in this bed. You better light a candle. You better take me to dinner. You better say something nice. Men and women are completely different. Men are only concerned about the destination. Women are all about the journey. We know that that's true today. Men are motivated by what they see. And women are motivated by what they hear. Now, these are generalities, but they're largely true today. Men and women are drastically, drastically different, and we need to understand that as we look at God's word for how we do this. Now, today, if you're taking notes, the title of the sermon, it's really, really important because it's really, really spiritual, because we're talking about godly sex. So if you're taking notes, because we're gonna jump into it, okay? So as we jump in, we got to put our tray tables up. We got to stow away our carry-on luggage because we're taking off, all right? So take out your notes. And this sermon is simply titled, This Is How We Do It.
This is how we do it.
Hey.
This is how we do it.
Come on.
This is how we...
Okay, that's cool. That's okay. Stop. We're in church. We can't listen to that. We're talking about godly sex today. This is how we do it. Every pun intended. Let's open up our Bibles to Song of Solomon, chapter 1. Song of Solomon, chapter 1. It looks like my son... there we go. I found it. It's okay. I thought my baby moved my marker. Song of Solomon, chapter 4, verse 1. We're going to jump right into it. Now here we go. Before I start, you need to understand something. Again, like I said, men and women are different, and this is okay. Up until this point... she has been talking 75% of the time. Men and women are very different. That's actually like a proven thing. They did a study, and they say women speak on average 80,000 words a day. Men speak on average 15,000 to 20,000 words. Very different. she's done 75% of the talking up to this point, and now he's about to speak up. And how many of us, like, typical men? Right, but now he's gonna talk. Men, take notes. He's gonna say 11 verses before he ever touches her. That right there is some of the best advice I've given you about sex all day. Okay, yeah, talk before. Okay, good. Okay, here we go. Verse 1, it says this. He says, "How beautiful you are, my darling. Beautiful beyond words. Your eyes behind your veil are doves." So notice, he's about to start working his way down. "Your eyes behind your veil are doves. Your hair is like a flock of goats." Let me explain. You're like, this is, men, do not say this. This is the worst line you've ever said. Some of you men, you didn't take my advice, and you were sitting at Valentine's Day with your wife on Monday, and you were like, "Baby, your eyes are like pigeons." New York City, I'm contextualizing it. "Your hair is like goats." Like, no, this is a bad line. But what's happening here? He says, "Your hair is like a flock of goats descending from the hills of Gilead." And in that part of the world, there are these hills with these goats that had black hair. And when they would stampede down the hills, it would create this like waving motion. So what he's really painting the picture for is he's really kind of trying to show you that she's doing this thing, you know, where you take off the bun. That's what's happening here. So I want to remind you where we are in the story. In the first week, they were getting to know each other, and they found out what they were attracted to about one another. And if you didn't learn about that, what you're looking for in someone that you want to be finding. And then last week we talked about a lot about courting, about dating, and other things too. So now they are married, and this is the wedding night. And she's undressing before him, and these are his words about her. So again, this is a PG-13 sermon. So if you have a child underage here, then maybe consider church kids. So he's saying, "You're so beautiful, my darling, beautiful beyond words. Your eyes are like doves. Your hair falls in waves like a flock of goats." Winding down. Now he keeps working his way down. You go to, that's just verse 1. Ooh, it's going to get a lot better. You go to verse 2. He says, "Your teeth are like a flock of sheep just shorn, coming up from the washing. Each has its twin, and not one of them is alone." You're like, wait, what? What? That's odd. What's he saying? He's saying you have teeth. They're white, and all of them are there. which counts, you know, that's important, especially back then. All of them are there. Now what we actually learn here is two things. One, she's not a hockey player and she's not from Arkansas. Sorry, that was a joke. Sorry if you are from Arkansas and you're joining us today. Some of you, like, you can't even handle that joke. He says, "Your smile is flawless. Each tooth matched to its own." So again, he's working his way down. He keeps going. He says, "Your lips are scarlet ribbon. Your mouth is lovely. Your temples behind your veil are like halves of a pomegranate." And pomegranates are red. So this is the first time he's seeing her unveiled. This is the first time he's really looking her in the eyes. So as she's undressing, as she's taking off her veil, he's finally really getting to see who she is, and he's saying, "Wow, you are so beautiful," and he's really cherishing her, and he's really celebrating her, really affirming her. And then it keeps going on, and he says this, and this is actually my favorite line. He says, "Your neck is like the Tower of David." Now, men, don't use that line. That won't work. But let me explain to you what's happening there. He's saying, "Your neck is like the Tower of David, jewels with the shields of 1,000 heroes." You see, the Tower of David in Jerusalem would have been the most honorable, most noble place in the city. And what he is saying about her is he's saying, "Man, the way that you carry yourself, with such honor and nobility, man, I'm so attracted to that about you." And this is actually really important for us to understand because there's a big lesson to learn here, because there's been a lot of women who haven't been cherished and a lot of women who haven't been treated like the nobility that they are. And because of that, they don't carry themselves the way that God intends for them to carry. So men, it's really important the way that you treat the women in your lives. Women, it's really important how you treat the men in your lives. But this is important not just for romantic relationships. This is important for parents to their children. When you don't honor, when you don't treat someone with respect, you rip away their confidence. And as they grow older, they don't carry themselves with the same nobility that they should. And this is really important today. So there's a few extra notes not in your notes there for you today. But she celebrates this. He celebrates this. So you can go back to the David scripture. Your neck is beautiful as the Tower of David. And it's just, so what are we learning here? Number one, the first point for us today is that godly sex is affirming. Okay. Wow. This is essential. Godly sex is affirming. Notice that what he is doing is he is starting with his words and he is celebrating who she is. Yeah. Men and women are different. It's really important that we understand that our relationships, they need to be affirming. And women typically want to be affirmed for who they are. And men typically want to be affirmed for what they do. What they've done. I really want to encourage you today, especially if you're in a relationship with someone else. Man, if there's a man in your life, start celebrating, hey, man, I see how hard you work. I see what you did there. That makes men really feel like, oh, man, you see me. I'm doing my best. Men, do your best to celebrate who she is. You are beautiful. You are noble. You are awesome. Celebrate her. In fact, this is something that I try to do because I think it's so important that we affirm constantly, constantly. Affirm, affirm, affirm. It's so important that we affirm our spouses. Something that I do is I'm doing my best to even get better at it. But whenever I think about Kristen, because how many of you know I think about her a lot? She's too pretty for me not to be thinking about. And I've decided that whenever I think about her, I'm just gonna, to my best ability, I'm gonna rip out my phone and just say, "Hey, baby, I know I'm sitting in a meeting, but I'm thinking about you." And let me tell you that I turn that crock pot on at about 10 a.m. Okay. And I let that meat simmer all day. You gotta get that nice and tender, fall off the bone kind of stuff. Let me tell you something. I don't have 3 kids because I'm good looking. Okay, there's some good advice here for you today. Affirming. Godly sex, godly relationships are affirming. I see who you are. I celebrate who you are. And here's the thing. Right now, it might be easy for you to say, well, Pastor, that's easy for you. You're dating. I am dating. We still date. You're married to Kristen. She's probably got everything together. It must be so easy to affirm her. She probably is awesome to you at home. And maybe you're a woman here today, and you're saying, well, that must be easy for Kristen to affirm you. You're a pastor. You're probably so perfect, and you have everything together. And you don't know my husband. You don't know my wife. I can't affirm her. There's nothing. They're a mess. I want to encourage you today. One, we're not perfect. We don't have it all together. Two, it's so important that you don't affirm necessarily who they are. You need to affirm who you think they can be. You need to stop speaking to who their shortcomings today and start speaking to their potential for tomorrow. And begin to celebrate any small thing that you can day in and day out. And you start speaking to who they can become. It's so important today with my kids, for instance, like when they make mistakes, you know what I don't do? The other day, I pick up Nora from school, and she did something at school, and she didn't tell me the truth about it. She lied about it, my little 4-year-old daughter. After school, the next day, I went to the teacher. After I dropped her off, I was like, hold on real quick. Hey, did you do this yesterday to Nora? She's like, no. And I was like, oh, well, she told me this. And like, oh, no, I didn't tell her. Like, okay, thank you. I'll take care of it later. And I picked up my daughter from school, and I made a moment of it. I didn't make it a big, scary moment. I didn't say, what's wrong with you? You lied to me. I didn't come down on her and remind her of her shortcomings. I didn't speak to what she did. No, I did something else. I picked her up. I had a little treat for her when I picked her up. I took her to a coffee shop that's
that I knew she would like. Not my favorite coffee shop, but one that sells flowers and coffee. So it's really pretty. She loves that kind of stuff. She's there. She's like, "Ooh, Daddy, I've never been. This is so pretty." And I was like, "Yeah, we're going on a little date." And I sit her down. And this is all for one conversation. And I sit her down. We're there for about 20 minutes. And I get her a croissant from the coffee. She's just on cloud nine. She's so happy. And as she starts to eat her treat, I grab her hand across the table. And I look in there and I say, "Nora, I need to talk to you about something really important." And she said, "Okay, Daddy." And I said, "Yesterday you told me this. But that's not true, is it?" She said, "No, Daddy. That didn't happen, did it?" "No, Daddy." It's like, "Nora, you never need to lie to me again. You did that, but that's not who you are." And I began to affirm who she is. And I began to build her confidence and her trust in her father who loves her. I affirmed her. I celebrated her. And I spoke to who she could be, not to what she did. Couples today, you need to affirm. You need to use your words. Your words bring life to people. Proverbs says that a word aptly spoken is like settings of gold apples in a silver jar on a table, meaning that your words need to be saying you are beautiful and you are valuable, and you need to speak that truth. Amen? Amen. Godly sex is affirming. It's affirming. So we're going to keep going here, because now it gets really good. Verse 5, he says this. He says, "Your breasts are like two fawns, like twin fawns of a gazelle that browse among the lilies." Let me explain. Have you ever been hunting? No, this is New York City. I've never been hunting either, okay? I don't know if I want to do that. Like, to be honest, like, you're like sitting there and you're like, "I'm going to kill this creature now. Are you going to eat it?" Probably not. Like, I don't know. Like, I don't get it. If you're a hunter, good for you. That scares me. I don't want to get a tick off the deer I kill. I don't know. I'm just like, I live in the city. Amen. Maybe I should go hunt rats. You know, that's a different thing to hunt. But I've been told that when you go hunting, let me tell you what you don't do. You don't go, "Hey, fawns, I'm here." Right? Why? Because those suckers are going to run away. That's what he's talking about in this scripture. He is speaking to the gentle, as he's getting to the more sensitive part of her body for the first time, he is coming in, and he is coming in sensitively. He is coming in slowly. This is the second part about godly sex. Godly sex is tender. This is really important. Godly sex is tender. We get a lot of questions from people saying, "Pastor, what's acceptable in the marriage bed? What's acceptable? Like, can we like experiment with some stuff? Can we like do some stuff? Like, can we do that?" And I want to say yes, 100% you can. But the advice that we give that I think is so important today is that whenever the conversation or the desire to maybe try different things comes up, it should always be judged through the lens of the woman. Whether or not this is something, because, and this is just from experience, most of the time, these are men pushing the envelope, and these are women who are maybe unsure about stuff. And I just think it's really important, men and women, that godly sex is tender. It's not... What is he saying here? He's saying that you are not the object of my passion. You are not just something, you're not just a body to fulfill my needs. There is deeper intimacy happening here. There is a tender love that is compassionate, that is loving, that is kind, that treats her and treats him with respect. This is so important today. We talked about the affirming, and now we're in the tender. It's just so important. Like, never demean a woman's body with your words. That she is not an object. He is not an object. Godly sex is affirming. It is tender. It's so important for us today. He keeps going on. He says, in verse 6, he says, "Until the day breaks. Until the day breaks and the shadows flee, I will go to the mountain of myrrh and to the hill. This is important. He says, until the day breaks. This is not Lionel Richie saying, all night long, all night. All night long. Okay, that is what he is saying. He's saying, until the day breaks, we're doing this, girl. He's like, I am here for it. And he says, and I will go, and he speaks of these two hills, the mountain of myrrh to the hill of incense. He is describing her body, and he's celebrating this. And this is really important today, because what he's saying is that godly sex is passionate. See, this is important because there is a lie out there that people have bought and they believe that if you give your life to Jesus, that if you choose to do it his way, that your life and that your passions are somehow going to be less than everyone else. Some people believe that once you start living God's way, all the fun is gone. I'm going to go to heaven, but it's going to be real boring getting there. That's what people think. And that is a lie from the pit of hell. It's a lie from the pit of hell. Here's the thing, friend. Passion has to be pursued. It has to be pursued. Passion is not assumed. Meaning that passion should be a part of every godly marriage, and godly sex should be passionate. But that passion, you know what? It will fade if it's not pursued. It's a real thing. You've got to work to keep the passion alive. Last week, I told you a little bit about fire. I love fire. I grew up as a kid. I was a pyrotech. I was a pyromaniac. I almost lit my house on fire when I was a little kid. I broke into my grandma's house. I stole her box of matches, and I started a fire in my own house. I was out of control. I was playing with stuff that I couldn't handle. And I was starting fires in all the wrong places. But fire, is fire a bad thing? No. Is fire a bad thing in the wrong place at the wrong time? Yes. You've seen the forest fires that has devastated the West Coast. You have seen, in our city, we've seen apartment buildings, people losing their lives, all at untamed fire. Is fire bad? No. It's supposed to be a tool that gives us warmth, that helps us provide, cook our food. But fire keeps engines going. I mean, like fire is a tool. It's a gift from God that should be a blessing. But when you put in the wrong place at the wrong time, it's destructive. So where is a fire appropriate? Well, a fire is appropriate in a fireplace. It's appropriate in a fireplace to give warmth to your home. It's appropriate in a stove to cook your food. It's appropriate in an engine to keep it going. And it's up to us to understand that we need to, one, make sure the fire is in the right place, but two, we've got to keep the fire going. Godly sex is supposed to be passionate. And I want to encourage you to see what happens to a lot of people when you hear the testimonies of people who say, I get married and, you know, and we just kind of drifted apart and we just didn't really love each other anymore. And I mean, I hear it all the time. I hear, you know, I just like that people, years go on, and there's a big trend right now where people are opening their marriages. There's a very small percentage of people, but more than ever, people are opening their marriages to more partners, thinking that that's going to invite more satisfaction. It's not. It's inviting destruction. And it's really important that we understand this, because God's intention for your marriage, God's intention for sex, is that it breeds intimacy. You see, I mentioned how men and women are different, and you'd go, why would God do that? like why would he make us so different if we're supposed to be together? And the truth is, we think different. We respond differently. We have these. We're different. And what that's for is it's God's way of teaching us to understand and to serve somebody other than ourselves. Because true intimacy, deep intimacy, comes with when two people decide to serve one another and to understand one another. God's desire is intimacy for us, but the world's desire for us is infatuation. And infatuation is a different thing. It's a temporary thing. And the Latin root of the word infatuation is ignis fatuus, which literally means false fire. It's a false fire. It's like those fake fireplaces we have in New York City. It's like, I love my fireplace. We have one in our apartment. That thing is ugly. But it's better than nothing. But the enemy offers us a lot of false fires. A lot of us, the passion begins to wane, so we pick up the false fire of pornography. And what that does is we think that will meet a need that's not being met, but what it's really doing is it is eroding your passion for your spouse. You are giving yourself a different desire, and you really, what you're doing is you're objectifying women, and you, every time you watch it, you are giving yourself a picture for what gets you excited and for what you think you want, and guess what? Your spouse will never live up to it. And you're creating a new standard for your marriage. You're creating a new standard for your spouse, and you're saying that my passions are now going to be for this, because this is what excites me. This is what lights my fire now. It's a false fire. And it will ruin. It will destroy. Okay? Let's all take a deep breath. Oh, dang, this is a lot. Okay. Elbow your neighbor and say, he's talking to you. No, don't do that. Don't do that. Don't do that. okay, he says, godly sex is it's affirming, it's tender, it's passionate, and then he goes on here in verse 9. He says, "You have stolen my heart, my sister, my bride." I love that. How awesome is this? And the band can actually come back up. "You have stolen my heart, my sister, my bride." He says, "With one glance of your eyes, with one jewel of your necklace, like you so easily you've stolen my heart." And I love this today, because what he is doing here is he is saying, you are now my standard. You have my heart. Not those other false fires that I could have given my life to, I could have given my heart to, I could have become infatuated with. No. You are the apple of my eye. In fact, he goes on and he says, "How delightful is your love, my sister, my bride. How much more pleasing is your love than wine, and the fragrance of your perfume more than any spice." Where am I? Yeah. There's one word and you need it. It's so important. I've never done this, as you know. And he says, "You have stolen my heart, my sister, my bride. You have stolen my heart with just one look in your eyes. How delightful is your love, my sister. How much more pleasing is your love than wine, and the fragrance of your perfume than anything else. Your lips' sweetness is the honey." He's just going on and on. He starts from the top. He works his way down. And now he's saying, you have stolen my heart. And really, he's used all these words in to describe her and to remind her how valuable she is and how beautiful she is. And really, he's trying to build something inside of her. He's trying to make her secure. And that's really important. Godly sex is secure. It, when we do it the world's way, it breeds insecurity. I had a professor once, and I asked him, "Why do you do it this way? Like you chose to be a virgin until you got married," and I was like, "What's your advice to someone how do you make that argument, especially in our culture?" And he was saying, "Well, Taylor, I kind of think about it this way: if I and my wife to be were able to keep our hands off each other, though we are madly in love, passionate about each other, not married yet, excited, dating, man, we really want to take it further, but we can't. If we are able to teach ourselves the self-discipline, the self-control to deny ourselves, though we are in love, how much more security am I going to have in trusting her later on when we're married to not go do something stupid with someone she doesn't really, truly love? And I was like, man, that's a good point. Because godly sex should be secure. It should be affirmed. It should make you feel like you're the only one and you'll always only be the only one. My eyes do not wander. You are now the standard. You are what I'm looking for. You are all that I want and I need in anyone. It should do that. When you do it God's way, it affirms other things. It affirms that I needed to taste a bunch of other things to see what my preferred flavor is. That means that maybe there's more things you haven't tried. Maybe you don't really know if you keep going down that line of thinking, and that's not what it's supposed to do. So godly sex is affirming, it's a tender, it's passionate, it's secure. And he goes on, and I read those scriptures, and he says, how delightful is your love, much more pleasing than wine. And I love this. He says, your lips drop sweetness as milk of the honeycomb, my bride. Milk and the honeycomb are under your tongue. I love this because that means that they're kissing and their mouths are open. Friends, that's a French kiss 1900 years before France ever became France. They're French kissing. And I know that's a joke, but it is true, just again, that the world has taken claim of something God started. That's not a French kiss. That's a Hebrew kiss. I don't care what you say. Our God is cool. These are his ideas. This is his design. He says, the fragrance of your garments is like the fragrance of Lebanon. He says, you are a garden locked up, my sister, and your spring enclosed, a sealed fountain. He goes on, and he actually says, you are a garden, a fountain. In verse 16, he says, awake, north wind. And come, south wind, blow on my garden. Now she begins to talk, that its fragrance may spread every way. She's talking about her body. And this is important because the last 2 weeks we've ended with a verse where she says, do not awaken love until it so desires, right? That's how we ended the last 2 weeks. But now here she is at the end of all of it. And now she is saying, awaken. Awaken, love. North wind, that's a strong, heavy wind. Come south wind, that's a gentle, tender wind. Blow on my garden, she's talking about her body, that its fragrance may spread everywhere. Let my beloved come into his garden and taste in its choice fruits. See, godly sex is supposed to be holy. Affirming, tender, passionate. Secure, holy. See, when we do it God's way, it should breed so much more satisfaction, so much more intimacy. But the truth is, right now, you know, we see this list and we hear this sermon, and the truth is, we're sitting here, and so many of us, we've dropped the ball. We haven't lived up to this standard. It's been less than perfect. And for so many of us, there's so much shame here. Shame because of what we've done. But what we've learned in the past few years is there's so many people that this is such a shameful topic because they encountered sex not by their choice before they ever wanted it. And I'm speaking specifically mostly to women now. And I want you to know if that's you, if that happened to you, that God makes all things new. That God sees your pain and your shame, that you're welcome here, you're accepted, you're loved, you're beautiful, you're amazing, and you are not what happened to you. Jesus makes all things new. Today, maybe you're thinking to yourself, well, Pastor, I just haven't done that because I just messed up. I haven't lived up to that standard. Well, from this day forward. You see, the truth is this is the gospel message. The gospel message is that God set a standard. And that standard is something that you and I could not have lived up to, and we did not live up to. We were far from that standard. So you know what happened? Jesus came to earth to pay the price, to pay the debt of the standard that you and I did not live up to. He died on the cross for the sin that you and I carry, and he raises to life and gives us a new beginning, a new start, a new resurrection. And then what happens is he gives us his word to be able to align ourselves to say, all right, God, this is I'm going to do it. And he fills us with his Holy Spirit so that we can become who he is calling us to become. This message, it might feel discouraging, but friend, don't be discouraged, because when God's word calls you to do something, it means that he will give you the capacity and the ability to do it. He'll never ask you to do something that he won't help you do. He'll never ask you to be someone that he doesn't believe you can be. This isn't impossible. This is God's best plan for your life. See, it's so important today that we do it this way, because God's way, it's not just right, it's better. It's better. We know it based off of studies that people who choose this direction, they report more satisfaction in their sex, more fulfilling sex life. They by far stay together longer than people who don't do it this way. And the data just over and over proves that people find the intimacy that God originally intended. So today, with every head bowed and every eye closed, we have an opportunity to make a commitment to no longer chase false fires, to pursue things that will provide temporary infatuation, pleasure for a moment, at the stake of risking intimacy for a lifetime. Today, I want to be sensitive to the nature of the topic. I'm not going to ask people to raise their hands, and we're not going to do that today. Instead, right where you're at, maybe you feel the Lord speaking to you, and you need God to make all things new in your heart today. If that's you, I just want you to talk to God with your head bowed, your eyes closed, and I just want to say, God, I want you to make all things new starting today. I want to do it your way from this day forward. God, because I want to be holy as you are holy. I want to be holy so that I can know you better, so that I can find the fulfillment that I so desperately long for. God, I pray over marriages in this place today, God, that they would be more intimate, God, that they would be more affirming, more tender, God, more passionate, God. God, I pray that you would fill them, God, with a love and a fire for one another. God, I pray that they would find security in who they are in you and security in their relationship. And God, I pray that their homes and their relationships would be holy. God, I pray this over our church today. God, that today is a new day. That the burdens of yesterday don't need to carry into tomorrow. I feel like God wants to set some people free today who have been carrying shame. If you're carrying shame in this area, again, I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand. But right now, I just want you to receive the forgiveness. I want you to receive the holiness. I want you to receive the purity that God is bestowing on you today. You don't have to carry that hurt. You don't have to carry that shame. You are not what you did. You are not what happened to you. You are precious. You are amazing. You are loved. You are valuable. God loves you today. So God, I pray freedom over each and every man and woman in this place. God, I pray that today would be a new day. In Jesus' name, everybody said, amen, 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 amen. Come on, can we give God a shout of praise? Hey, let's stand to our feet all over this place. And I want to take a moment, something that we always do at the end of our services. We always give an opportunity for people to say, Pastor, today I haven't been living for Jesus. Like you're talking about all this, but God created sex, and the blessings and the benefit and the enjoyment, the pleasure, the purpose, all the good things God has for us comes with the assumption that we are living our life for and with Jesus.
And today is an easy opportunity. It's a new opportunity to say, God, I'm giving you my whole life. Not just a portion of my life, not just a few hours on a Sunday every week. No, God, I'm giving you my whole life. My past is yours, my present is yours, and my future is yours. I want to spend eternity in heaven, God, so I'm giving you my everything. So today, if you need to make that decision, if you need to give your life to God, maybe it's for the first time or the first time in a long time, no matter where you are, I want you to know that it's never too late to start again. God loves you. He's not mad at you. You're not bad. You are good. We've all made mistakes, and God wants to invite you into a new relationship with him. All you have to do is lift up your hands and say, God, I'm giving you my life today. As a statement of faith, with our hands lifted, I want you to say, God, I give you my life. I put you first. My past, my present, my future. Begin to tell him in your own words right now how you repent. You want to turn from living for yourself, and you want to turn to start living for him. But you want all of God. You want his blessings. You want his love. And you want to be fully devoted to him. God, with our hands raised to you, Lord, we lift up our voice, and we're reminded that our life is built on you. Come on, church, lift up your voices, sing out this song, and declare it in Jesus' name.